That's exactly what I want. These are the last step for our mizzen mast. When the mast slides down in there, this gives us a slot weld so we can weld a little bit down this side and up the other and fill it in, grind it off. It'll disappear eventually, but this gives us more surface area.
Yeah, so I'd say just put a mark on it right here and cut it off.
The big bone downstairs on the plug and the cord.
Oh, cool. All right, this is our fix for this, our bulwark's moving apart. A slot here will let us use any bolt, and doesn't matter where the steel goes. Yeah, you gotta turn it a little bit. Look at that!
Sweet! That's not too chabby.
Okay. Here is an amazing Bill's pump. About $60 for that pump. It is running one. The bad thing is, it's 110 volt AC, but I would love to figure out how to run AC off the battery without it being a problem, meaning electrocution. It's just if you buy a marine pump that's that, you're going to pay, you know, $400.
Yeah.
Peter has learned not to break screws, which is something all of us have to do on this project. He's making the beautiful core fittings around the mast. You didn't fall, did you?
You what?
You didn't fall, did you?
No.
Hey, don't do that, it'd be bad. Here, I got it. Oh, you need some slack. Oh, we're wrapped up down there, yeah. And Chris here is down from, well, you're really from, where in Texas?
Tyler, Texas.
Tyler, Texas. Yes. He's from Tyler, he's a pipe fitter working up in Wichita, so he's come down to help us out today. Thanks.
Like on a 3-point hitch, that thing you shove through and flip over?
Right, yeah.
Pinch it in with the boards.
It's the back plug is right there. Don't go any faster than close.
They move that with a sky crane?
Yeah.
Those guys.
Heads up!
That's this one.
Filmmaker's Apprentice. Everybody keep telling us to get this book. We got it, okay?
This is practice, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And so what I did is I didn't mark the straight part of the rope on this first part.
Yeah.
Look how it twisted on me.
Oh, you did a
Because I didn't mark it.
Yeah.
This one I marked.
Right.
And I had a system. Now, I think my stitches are supposed to go...
Now, to explain this, we pull the rope taut and we mark it. If you don't do that, you tend to roll the rope as you go, or the rope has a twist in it that naturally pulls the fabric.
And then your sail is all
crookedy. And then your sail has this type of stuff in it. So that's why you saw us in the video already tighten this rope up and put a mark down the top of it when it was tight. We think we got all the twist out of it, so now we just follow that mark.
Okay.
Oh.
Come on, for $8, what do you expect?
That's awesome.
Right? A point. Weller makes one for about $70.
I have the Weller, but it actually didn't work. What I did is I took my Weller big old soldering iron and added this tip to it, and it didn't actually work too well because when it poked through finally, it burned too big with this hole here, and if I made this just even a quarter inch longer, it didn't get hot out there. And I actually made one of these even out of stainless steel TIG filler wire, and it didn't even work at all. So you really do have to use whatever the resistance is of this metal that they have on their rigs.
And all of these are acceptable.
Right.
Look, they don't have this big black crusty edge.
I burned these with a TIG rod.
Yeah. And they are kind of
They
evil.
Are a little sharp.
This
that's
one.
What I'm, that's what I'm worried about. This leaves a little bit of a sharp edge. And my thought is this rope stretches and pulls back and forth.
Feel this.
It's going to saw through it.
This is like heavy.
I'm not saying it will. I'm just thinking it will. It's just one of those overthinking. I'm being paranoid.
Look how secure that is.
You know, the boat's going to catch on fire and sink. And this, we don't want this to be the cause. You know? Because everybody's got to be afraid of something. I'm choosing this to be my fear today. How's that?
Okay, I'll tell you what. Yeah. If that fails because of these holes...
You'll do it again.
I will get in the tender and go far, far away.
That's it.
That was it. And see, there's just a little hole on the backside, but that's all I need.
Yeah, right.
Depends. If you're just going through the normal three layers...
Yeah.
The
needle is fine.
You can get through there provided you've got this table. So
this is called a palm because it's in your palm. And you're supposed to drive the needle through with that.
But I've found it's really, for what I'm doing, I'm just going to show you on this, okay? Which is just my sample.
Put the needle in the hole.
But you put the needle in the hole. And you just go like that.
You just
that.
Push it down against the table.
Yeah. Now, you know, if I'm good enough, I can actually get it through in one go. One go. So that's
cool.
I think we'd be ready to go.
And we all need like 1,500 stitches per sail.
This is.
This is more like twine than it is thread.
It is.
Yeah, it's made for that speedy stitcher sewing all.
Some people said use 4 strands of the sewing machine thread.
This is much more than 4 strands of the sewing machine thread.
This is so much easier. It's already just, waxed.
And it's just one strand.
Yeah.
You don't have to mess with 4.
And I'm using a 14 or 15 needle.
Okay.
I didn't go with a bigger one because I don't need it.
Right.
Size is 13 through 19.
Huh. Oh yeah, there's the big one. It's got a triangular tip on it.
So I'm using the second to the smallest one. Yeah, they all do.
Oh, yeah.
So you can easily sharpen it on your thingy do.
Yeah, a grinding wheel.
Yeah, I like that better.
Okay. Next step is every foot or so, we're stitching the rope to the cloth, and that way she doesn't have to come back and worry about this slit down, because we have a little tension on the rope and the cloth is laid out nice and flat. That way we'll be able to let go with the clamps and slide the sail around, work it in the lap.
But no, they don't come down.
Oh, that's right, yeah.
No shoving these to a sail bag.
Unless there's damage or...
But that's the beauty of a junk sail. There's no sail change.
Right.
It goes
that's awesome.
Down and up, and that's it. You bought the plans for a...
54 Bruce Roberts.
What?
Cut files where you can just send them to somebody and have it cut for you.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
To the CAD cut files?
Yeah, to the CAD cut files. Which was what I was going to do, because it takes a ridiculous amount of time to cut all the parts. all of his plans come with three to four different, I think there's four different layouts, five different sail plans. You know, you can pretty much, when you buy his boat, you pretty much, you buy the 54 Bruce Roberts, you pretty much buy all the options. I think there's like 250 pages of plans.
Really?
Yeah, it's ridiculous.
Is it paper or PDF or
it's,
what?
It's paper. And I even got to the point where I bought a lot of the steel.
Oh, did you?
Yeah, I'd started just buying stuff and storing it and getting ready to build the boat. And I found your video, just got consumed by it.
Yeah. Yeah, well, I had looked at a Trader 65 by Bruce Roberts. So.
I watched the first, till the hole was complete, I probably watched those videos 15 or 20 times. And I was raring to go. But as time went on, and the more I watched your videos,
the more details,
the more I realized the scope of the project, I came to the conclusion that I wanted to be a sailor and not a boat builder. And I was pretty sure, watching what you were going through, that there was a pretty good chance I wasn't going to finish the boat. Thank you, saved me a lot of grief.
Yeah, because there is a lot of grief in having to start a project and then deciding halfway through, it's like, Jesus, this isn't for me. It's driving me nuts.
Right.
And if it's not adding to your life, then it's sucking away from your life. So, and we only got that one life.
Right.
So what do you have now?
I bought a 40-foot sailboat. Changed my work schedule where I can work really hard throughout the year and take the summer off.
Yeah.
And when my kids are out of school, we'll sail for the summer, whether it be a month or 3 months.
You figure out the boat, you figure out things you want to change and fix on it. And then the plan in 3 years then is?
When my youngest son graduates, then we can go.
You go.
I definitely want to circumnavigate.
Yeah.
I like to dive. I want to see the South Pacific. I want to see the Indian Ocean.
Yeah.
The last part of the world is still pretty wild.
Yeah.
That's not freezing. So there's a lot of things I want to do. So I've got 3 years. This is probably not going to be the boat that I take that trip on.
It may be. Right?
I stay in an RV a lot.
And
the thing about RVs is you really don't know what you want until you buy one.
Yeah.
You got to just buy one. Then you know what you want. So that's kind of where this boat is. I need to learn how to sail. I've been sailing a handful of times. So
me too.
I'm going to use this boat to learn how to sail.
I'm going to use that one to learn how to sail.
Make sure that my new wife likes sailing. There's a lot of things to get worked out. And then in 3 years, maybe I'll buy a new boat.
Yeah.
Maybe I won't. But this boat's ready to sail, and I paid a little over $20,000 for it. And it's ready to go.
Oh, that's not bad at all.
Right.
Yeah.
And, I'll probably have half that much in it again.
Yeah,
pretty easily.
It's easy to do.
With electronics.
Replacing winches and radars and things like that, sure. But anyway, that's the important lesson here is if you don't want, getting into sailing is great, but if you're going to build a boat so that you can get out there on the water cheap, go out and buy the used boat like this. That's the way to do it. Don't build one. You build a boat when building is really what you want to do. You want to build a boat and then sail on that boat. That's my dream, so that's not everybody's dream. So pick the one that's right for you and don't go live somebody else's life, because these things do take years to complete. So there's the great lesson. You'll be out on the water this summer.
Absolutely.
And I'll be in the cargo hold this summer.
You'll have to come down.
But I'm happy in my cargo hold and you be happy on the water. And I'll catch up to you some year.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
We can go around the horn together.
You'll be easy to see coming.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, it'll be the big one with the red sails on it.
Right. Right.
Yeah. But anyway, that's great. I appreciate you sharing that.
Hey, no problem.
So which car do you want to pack now first? You ready to start this day, Jez? Yeah, let's build a boat.
Burning, I think this is
the rubber. Oh, it's a tank. Yeah, the rubber. All right, that'll be good. Now you have to go hold that over there. Yeah, I forgot to put my rubber gas in. It's just getting exposed. Got it?
Yep.
Water to put on that. Okay. I'll sacrifice my tea. There we go. should have had hot tea this morning.
Let me check it.
Hey, what's going on, Doug?
How you doing?
I'm doing great.
How did I like your video stuff?
Yeah, thank you.
You were lower.
No, two.
Two?
Put the border band to cut this?
Four line band.
Got it?
Yeah. Your chipping hammer.
Yeah.
Lay it right
now
there.
They switch the MIG.
This is coming down the street for B-roll. One more. In the view, you're starting to know when the resistance is. Alright, 10 pumps.
Yeah.
How close to the end of this do you want it? Right there where the number's at?
Right on top of the brace.
It's pumping the jack, we go.
Put a little lunch in you and you're much brighter.
Thanks, Tom.
Okay.
Well, I'll get you a wet rag and lay on top of it up there to keep it cool.
Yeah, that would be good.
All right. I don't remember who showed me this trick, but I'm glad they did. It's called a bird mouth or a fish mouth, or you just cut it at an angle from both directions. You know, one like this, and then we'll turn it over. And you get a shape that will fit over the pipe, so the other pipe will go in just like that. This is, and you just gotta fool around with the angle to get it right. This one's made to fit over the handrail pipe, and then it's actually a little too sharp to fit over that larger pipe that we welded it down to, but we'll just hit it against the belt sander and make it a little wider for the bottom.
Play around with it.
Be heavy.
Yep, it's gonna be heavy. Rule number one when you're cutting down materials, cut the long stuff, the big stuff first, because if you fuck it up, you can always turn it into the small stuff.
We got a beautiful blue sky out there today.
Oh, getting a trail.
Oh, contrail. Hey, chemtrail is what that is. Mind control.
Alright, this is our test piece. If this doesn't go, we've cut like 2/3 of the material out. Go ahead and bend that over. What it did, it creased mainly on just one of them.
Yeah.
It didn't really use the rest of them.
Take that notch, cut that notch in half.
I think so. I think we need a lot less notch. Oh, that's not...
It's hit,
yeah,
it's
see? Hit. We are going to have to cut 3 notches at least. That's much better.
Yeah.
It's the same crease. It cracked.
It folded down, but yeah, it's going to break it.
Yeah.
So we'll take the depth of the blade.
Yeah, let's raise the blade. Lesson. That crack broke.
Yeah, it's going to because we're putting so much
we're
leverage.
Too much, so actually, it's the other way around. Thinner is better. What a mechanical engineering school will get you in Germany, okay? We have kids going to high school learning nothing. He's learned to rig stuff. That's a brace pulled across there. It's a tightening strap, so he can bend this into the pipe in, and he's got a fulcrum here so that it can't bend in any further than this, so he's rigging it up. And that is just beautiful design.
And it's not German engineering, it's just anybody that takes the time to learn and study will get good at this. Use your brain, exactly.
All right.
More clamps.
You know what it did? Or why it did it that way?
Let's see if it broke it first.
It was in the middle.
That helps because it takes the force over there.
Yeah, it took the pressure off the
outside. That's the first one we've got in the bin. You like that? Paid $10. Paid $10 for that thing. God bless the Chinese. Yeah, broke it.
It did. Yeah, I can
right there. We're gonna cut 2-inch strips for you and you're gonna weld them on.
Okay.
So you'll have 60 feet of.
Or I can make them on actually this thick. So I think I'm just gonna put. I'm gonna put it where I have an outside corner.
Right. So you gotta fill it. You gotta fill it gap up on top.
Yeah. I'll make it where we can fill it gap up on top. And that's just grinding. Yeah. Good try. Not everything works.
There you go. There you go.
That looks good.
Yeah.
He was smart and he tacked these while it was out in place and then brought it in here so he can weld all these in the flat down position or letting gravity help him. And back in here behind the scenes, Betsy is hard at sewing another piece of rope along the sail. And I tell you what, it's a wonderful thing. And just as a side note, if you have issues with women, don't come here to work, okay? I don't want to listen to it. That's not me, and that's not what this place is about. We're about inclusion. Women, gays, everything. Should we include homophobes? No, we don't include homophobes.
Black, white, purple, pink, yellow.
Anybody, and anything.
Green. I'd take an Oompa Loompa. They're orange.
An Oompa Loompa?
They're orange.
How about a Teletubby?
Teletubbies, Martians.
Talk about undefined. There's undefined. So we're about inclusion. So if you're about inclusion, you'll fit in here well. If you're not about inclusion and you can keep your trap shut, you'll do okay. If you're a bigot in any way, just don't come. Please. Thanks. And that last comment's going to get, somebody's going to wonder, well, who's the bigot been? There really hadn't been a bigot here, but you know, recently we've had a great group of people and everybody's gotten along real well and there's been no problems or anything like that, and I just love that, and it's really because all these people have been very accepting. And I know what I'm talking about. I have been the bigot in my life. And I tell you what, not being a bigot is so much nicer. Not just easier on everybody else, it's so much easier on you. So if I can give any advice at all, it's just learn to love people for who they are. So awesome about this. I was at the office today. He did all this. It's cool.
Actually, Betsy, that did help.
See, it's a girl trick.
Yeah.
To put 3-in-1 oil on those rusty, scratchy, yucky bolts.
Peter is doing the sale.
Yeah. We go to the Tropical Smoothie Cafe.
Yeah, that sounds good.
Dooms.
Tell them what your profession is.
I'm an actor by trade.
Now tell them what you do. You do teaching, you do instruction, you do all kinds of things.
What leave it to?
Give us the list, the whole list.
I teach, I coach, I act myself. I run workshops. I run a website business.
And you teach social media too, which is all kind of like the new thing for actors.
It is.
Yeah, I didn't even think about that, unfortunately.
Now they're making casting decisions based on social media followership now.
So, hire the right people and your movie gets its advertising done. Yeah, that's kind of lazy. Well, I appreciate you telling sales.
Loving it.
You know, the next thing we need to do is start thinking about the hinges.
I was thinking about that.
I don't know.
And I think it would be good if the pivot is really low.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's pretty quick, actually.
And we are looking at a 502. I thought it was a 550.
That's what we call our 550.
That's what you call your 550. So this is a Radiarc 502, which is a Miller 550. Is that right?
It's the Miller Big Blue 500.
Miller Big Blue 500.
5 plus 20 is the 20 is the 20.
Yeah, 20 kVA. And so the big thing of this is it would go on the boat. It would be our welder. It would also be our generator. It puts out 110, 220, and three phase, right?
Yeah.
All right. That's Buford. Buford knows these things back and forward. They specifically talked to me about this one because it has a diesel engine in it that is almost indestructible, right?
Yeah.
And it's what we decided was it's not the current version. It's the older version of a Kubota. And it's a completely rebuilt system. So this has been out in the field and used, and then they take it into their shop and completely go through it. So it's in the same condition as a new machine. The only problems I can see with it for putting on a boat are some of the obvious issues. It can't go where I expected it to do because the door opens on this side. It's got a water cooler on it. You know, that'd be nice to lose that. The other side is the one that's sealed up. It has some ventilation. It has an integrated diesel tank, which I don't really need. But as far other than that, it's perfect. The good news is it has the diesel engine. It is almost indestructible, they say. And I believe these guys, they take good care of you down here. It has all the power we would need. 20 kW is more than enough. If it allowed us to bring people on board, you know, say, hey, do you have a lot of electricity? And the answer is yes. And we have it 110, 220, and three phase. The three phase runs the plasma welder better. And we probably can get enough 220 off of it to run the air compressor. So that means the plasma torch is taken care of with just running one engine instead of running two. And I see what? An oil filter and a fuel filter on there and a, what's this, just a trap?
A little filter and a water trap.
Yeah. And those electronic boxes you said are enclosed? Are they up here on the generator end?
Sitting right here.
Right. And you guys don't even have a hatch to them, so it's like...
No.
Right. Is there any fan up here in the front?
There is on the stator.
On the stator?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I can see it down in there. Yeah. And that pulls air from the front through the electronics?
Yeah.
Okay. And then the engine and the water-cooled system on them.
And I don't know, guys, if there's any reason for me to think about changing the water-cooling system out. I mean, we could save a little bit of space, but you know, I kind of think we need the fan blowing the air over the engine anyway. You know, I just haven't thought about it much. Maybe we put the blower pulling the air out of this case and blowing it upstairs above the deck. How do you ventilate an engine that's already in an enclosed box? Do you just let it vent into the engine room and then clear the engine room, or do you put something specific onto this? All right, 110. What's this, 220?
220.
And then?
20 amps.
What's this?
This is 220.
There's another 220.
Yep.
How is it different than this 220? Just different,
different
type plugs is all you're doing?
Yep.
So you're giving me two optional plug. And then we run our own pigtail through here for three phase.
Yes.
What's that, a breaker for something?
Yes.
For the whole box? It's 50 amp. I guess so. Okay, yeah, it's for that one.
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
And then the welding lug is there.
Yep.
And the other welding lug is there.
Yep. And you got a on-off switch here for your 110s.
Okay. And then why do I have two sides to this? I got scratch.
One's remote control.
Oh, and the other one.
And the other one is hot all the time.
Right. I don't ever use that, so.
Yeah.
I use the red as the hot all the time.
Yep.
I even like when they get the color coding the way I like it. Okay, and I got.
This is max and mig. So if you turn it over here, you can run your CV, turn the CV.
Okay.
And all these others are just for stick.
Rubber. Yeah, stick and TIG.
Yeah.
And various voltage ranges.
Yeah.
So this is the major setting and this is the minor?
Right.
Okay. All right. Amps, hours, fuel. What's that?
Temperature.
All right. Simple enough. Pulling 500.
It didn't get any noisier. You hear it lug the engine a little bit, that's all. Yeah, I like that.
Down there.
The crane on the block.
One more.
Guess what?
It's working. Yeah.
There's a little proof that I do know how to stick well, sort of. I just don't like it.
They took the mud on the back side. That wasn't a weld. Holding the boat together with mud. A beautiful accent to any room. Yeah. You did a beautiful job welding it in, but have you seen the issue?
Okay. You see the issue?
The light's too big to go through the slot, so we have to disassemble the lights. And somebody welded the rods the hangers in.
Oh, that's too bad.
Alright. The floor and the cargo hole is done. Got all of them cut. Yeah!
Tomorrow is the engine room.
Main engine goes there, and that welder I was looking at, I kind of wanted it to go there, but it's turned the wrong way as far as access hatches, so we'd have to go back here, and that's where I want to put the Tormach mill, so maybe the mill would have to go down here. Anyway, there's room for it, and God, it'd be a lovely piece of machinery to have. We'll have to think about that one some more. Man, it's great to have the floors in here. And thank you all for sending all those pictures in that you're getting ready to see here on the end of this video. So if you've got a project that you want to post up here, I love those things. So send them to me. You just email them to me at svseeker@ymail.com, my email address, and put a project photo on there, and we'll be sure and put it up. Thank you.
got more rain forecasted for tonight and tomorrow.
This just never gets old.